Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. I'm JJ Harpster. I am the science section head for the Science, Technology, and Business Division here at the Library of Congress. I'd like to welcome you today to our program, Big Telescopes and Big Discoveries in Our Solar System. This program is presented through a partnership between our division and NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. And this is our first co-sponsored NASA event since 2019. We had been doing it for about 13 years. So we are just absolutely thrilled to be back hosting programs on space and earth science topics with our friends at NASA. So it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Stefanie Milam, who is a planetary scientist at Goddard. And she is also the James Webb Space Telescope Deputy Project Scientist for Planetary Science. And this is a role that she has been in since 2014. Dr. Milam has received her undergraduate degree in chemistry from Kansas Wesleyan University, and she completed her PhD at the University of Arizona in Tucson. As a postdoc, she researched interstellar ice analogs at SETI, at the NASA's Ames Research Center, and she joined Goddard in 2010 as a research scientist. So today, we are going to discuss some really big telescopes, more specifically the James Webb Space Telescope, the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope in Chile, which has been named the Vera Rubin Observatory, and also the next generation telescopes that are on the horizon. I don't know how you can get better than James Webb, but I guess we can. These big telescopes can reveal new insights into the formation, the history, the evolution, the composition of our solar system, and it also can show us uncharted territories, new worlds, moons, and those fun interstellar interlopers within. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Stefanie Milam to the Library of Congress.
Okay, thank you so much for coming and joining us today. This is really exciting for me to get to be here and to share all the latest and greatest that we're doing with the James Webb Space Telescope, but also what we're planning for the next generation telescopes. As we just mentioned, I've been working on the project. I was a liaison before I was a project scientist, so I've been on the project about 10 years. And can I tell you, this has been an amazing year. Watching the launch on Christmas Day, going through the exhaustive phase of unfolding our telescope in space while our journey to a million miles away, and then commissioning the telescope for 6 months, and then finally revealing our first images this summer. I hope you follow along on social media, the NASA web channel, all the images that are coming through almost daily. We had a brand new one coming out this morning. I hope you got to see it. If not, I will give you the big screen version of it. So I guess I'll go ahead and get started. So big telescopes in general. Why big telescopes? Well, there's a lot of reasons why we want bigger telescopes, both on the ground as well as in space. And a lot of that's just about getting a better resolution. The bigger we have of a telescope, the more we can hone in on the tiny, faint little signals coming from across the galaxy or even across the universe. There's a lot of advantages to having telescopes on the ground, but there's also even more advantages to having large telescopes in space. The Earth's atmosphere causes a lot of problems for us when we're trying to study things, especially when you think about clouds in the sky or when it's not nighttime, which really limits how much we can actually use ground-based telescopes if we're looking at visible light the way you and I would see. So we like to put things up in space, one, to get rid of that whole nighttime weather problems that we actually have from ground-based telescopes, but there's also other reasons to do so. So if you think about if we want to study planets around other stars and we want to see if there's another Earth 2.0, for example, that means we're looking for an atmosphere that looks like our own. And our own atmosphere happens to block all of that radiation that we would be looking for. So having a telescope in space, we can actually look for planets that actually look like Earth. So I'm just going to go through a little series here so you can get a little bit of perspective on bigger and bigger telescopes as we go through. So this is a beautiful image taken of the Carina Nebula. And you can see that it's beautiful clouds of gas and dust in the universe. It's actually within our own galaxy. This cloud and dust region is where stars are being formed and planets. And it's beautiful just with a regular naked eye view. If you walk outside on a clear night, you can see the Carina Nebula. But if you want to take a closer look, you can get a nice telescope. This is actually a ground-based telescope. And you can start seeing some of the structure within the nebula itself. They're very dynamic regions. This is, as I said, where stars and planets are being formed. So we see density of dust and gas actually collecting together. We see how it gets lit up by radiation, either from stars that have just recently formed or from stars in the nearby field. But we can't see through it with our own eyes because just like clouds in our own sky, it actually blocks visible light from penetrating. And so that's one of the reasons why we use different wavelengths of light to study things that are happening inside of these regions. But let's take another step in. So this is another closer view. This is actually a big telescope. It's the Lycia Observatory. So now we're talking about big glass on Earth, and that's a fun astronomer term is big glass. So this is a beautiful image of what we actually are looking at. And if we want to hone in on what we saw with the JWST first image, it's this red box here, you can see what we can actually do now with a beautiful resolution of a space-based telescope with the James Webb Space Telescope. Even more importantly, we're looking at infrared wavelengths. So now we can see inside of this gas and dust, and we can start seeing all these baby stars being formed. That's sort of the glitter that's speckled across this giant mountainous region. New stars have actually formed in this region, though, and that's what's eaten away all of the material in the top. So where all the dark blue sky-looking region is, these are all actual new stars that have just formed by eating away all of this material down here. And all of these other tiny little speckles are the new stars that are being formed and consuming all of this gas and dust. And if you zoom in further and further and further, you'll see more and more structure, more and more beauty. These images are absolutely fantastic. And if you haven't done so, go online, download the high-resolution image, and just start playing. Zoom in, zoom in, zoom in. You'll see things that you never thought you could ever see in one of these objects. So, new stars being born. This is a whole new era of astronomy for us in astrophysics. We're now studying processes and have the ability to study processes of things that we haven't been able to do with the sensitivity and the resolution of a large space-based infrared telescope. This includes now studying planets around other stars in ways that we haven't been able to do. So as I already said, if we're looking for the next Earth 2.0, we want to look for an atmosphere that looks like ours. So using the James Webb Space Telescope, we watch a planet go in front of its star, and just by peering through the atmosphere of that planet, we can study the composition. And so one of our latest results is actually the detection of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere of a planet. So this is a spectrum. So what you're looking at is a molecular fingerprint. So the same way you have a distinguishable fingerprint from one another, every molecule has its own fingerprint as well. So what we're looking for are these fingerprints of the key ingredients in Earth's atmosphere that would suggest that we have a planet somewhere else that may or may not have the same chemistry or maybe even dynamic processing, geology, volcanoes, dust storms, hurricanes, you name it. These things all change what we can see in the atmosphere and how we might observe it. So looking for peculiarities within other planets' atmospheres is a real hot topic and something that we hope to get a lot of really amazing discoveries with the James Webb Space Telescope and sort of give us a short list of what we want to do in the future with even bigger telescopes. So looking at planets around other stars, we've learned that the solar system is definitely unique. All the other planetary systems that we've observed to date, they tend to have very small orbits. The planets orbit very close to their stars. Some of them are extremely hot, and some of them are extremely cold. A lot of them are very big, and some of them are very small. But if you look, the dashed lines here are showing you where the planets in our own solar system are. So you see the inner solar system here, and here's another dashed line, here's another dashed line. So you can see that we have planets that exist much, much further from our star than all these other planetary systems. Some may say this is just the limit of what we can do with detection right now. So we're building bigger and better telescopes every couple of years and instrumentations to try to do even better and study if this is really an anomaly or not. But one thing we want to do is we want to understand the planets in our own solar system, because all of those other planets that we've now identified, over 5,000 today, we want to know what they look like. So that spectrum that I showed you from the James Webb Space Telescope, we have to model what the atmosphere of that planet looks like. So we have to have some basis or foundation for what that model includes. We know some of the basic observational parameters, so we know how big that planet is, we know how far away from its star it is, we know how regularly it goes around its star, and how hot the star may be. But there's other things that we want to actually understand and really understand what the composition looks like. So if you have things like a dust storm, it's really going to dampen how much atmosphere you can see. If you have weather patterns, it's going to change dynamically, almost in real time. And so these are things that we have to actually understand. So our basis for understanding these planets around other stars starts with our own solar system. We have to understand our own planets and our own solar system well before we can really understand and get down to the nitty-gritty of the planets and other systems. So we have this glorious fleet of spacecraft that are going all over our solar system. We've now reached the edge of our solar system. We study small bodies. We've been orbiting Jupiter. We spent over a decade orbiting Saturn and its moon Titan. We've studied Mercury. We've plunged into the sun now. We study our solar system in ways that nobody else had ever imagined or dreamed that we could do. It's hard, though, and unfortunately, it's expensive to do this. So we can't study everything and for long periods of time. These are the kinds of things that we really need to take into perspective as we start using other facilities to study and understand them. As well as planning for these missions, we have to have some foundational knowledge for why we want to send a probe to Europa, which has a huge ocean under the surface. We want to have some sort of understanding of what we're actually going to try to probe and understand, what that chemistry may or may not be. And remote sensing, so with telescopes either on the ground or in space, we can get a little bit of perspective and also help constrain what these other missions that we're sending, these million-billion-dollar spacecraft across the solar system, we can really refine what we're sending there. So directed missions are fantastic. We get beautiful images, things that we could never get with ground-based telescopes. We can study in glorious detail composition using mass spectrometry, for example, where we get individual molecular composition. We can do other things. We can do the geology of objects. We can understand what their interiors look like. We can understand if they have earthquakes. There's all kinds of things that we can do when we have a mission, a rover, a flyby, an orbiter, a lander, or even something like a probe. However, the remote observations with using other telescopes really gives us a broader perspective. One, we can only go to so many asteroids or comets or small bodies in the solar system. There's hundreds of thousands of them out there. So just going to one or a few is really a limited sample. So we want to know how that looks compared to the entire family bulk population of these small bodies across the solar system. We can do global science. If you have an orbiter, so say, for example, around Mars, you can imagine being on an airplane, and what you're seeing is just the ground beneath you, a city, a river, a mountain. You don't see the full global picture of what's actually happening. So when we have something orbiting a planet, you get sort of that close-in perspective, but you don't understand how a hurricane is forming, you know, in the Pacific Ocean and how that might be influenced by other geologic processes or even human properties that may alter the weather or environment of a given system. We fill in the gaps between missions. We don't get to go to Saturn every couple of years. And we're not going for another decade or so. So having a transition from the Cassini mission to when we send another mission out there is something that, you know, ground-based telescopes or space-based telescopes even can help fill those gaps, and we can understand the seasonal variation. We also can put better spectrometers on our telescopes. This is something that's pretty heavy, pretty bulky to put on a planetary mission. And we have other instruments that we really want to put close up to those planets or those other bodies. So with a space-based telescope, we can put a beautiful spectrometer or camera on it, and something that's far bigger, far more memory, and complex than something that we would put on a planetary mission. And as I already mentioned, we can get some details and provide some very useful information and fodder for future missions. Unfortunately, we haven't gone to the outer solar system. So we've had the Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 missions, which flew through our solar system and gave us some of the perspective of some of the outer solar system. But to date, we haven't been able to go there yet. It's very hard. It's hard to get power. It's hard to get communications in the outer solar system. And it's something that we really, really, really want to do. In fact, this was just prioritized in the Planetary Science Decadal that just came out. But we had our first glimpse with the Voyager 2 mission of our outer solar system, the ice giants, Uranus and Neptune. And that is it. We haven't been there since. So using ground-based telescopes has really been the only way that we've been able to study these objects in any kind of detail. And this is really critical because we know there's a lot of Neptune-like planets around other stars. And so that's something that we really want to understand and fundamentally gain some insight into as we start learning more and more these bodies exist. I already mentioned small bodies. These are all the comets that we've actually visited. It's just a few. Again, there are hundreds of thousands of these objects coming into the solar system almost daily. There's a lot of them that just sit there in their reservoirs waiting to be discovered. This is just a very small sample of the objects. And so far, every one of them that we've studied in any glorious detail, especially with a flyby mission, orbiter, or even lander now, it's very different from one another. And it's also different from what we measure remotely. So this is a comparison of what we would see for a flyby mission of Comet Hartley 2, and this is what we saw with a ground-based telescope, and actually a pretty small one, a 2-4 inch reflector. What we see in these two different perspectives are completely different. So sending a mission to an object is hard to put into context what we can do remotely, but this is the link that we're trying to constantly make, because we know there's hundreds and thousands of these objects that we can only observe in this manner. So putting in that bigger picture of what that composition means when we actually go to one of these objects and how we can spread that wealth of knowledge and apply it to the other objects across the solar system or even other planetary systems is really critical. Hubble. Hubble has been an amazing observatory. This is our first big glass in space, and it really was. It was a 2.4 meter diameter solid piece of glass mirror. So it really was a big mirror. And it had some amazing discoveries for our solar system. Play. Doesn't want to play. I broke it. That really sucks. Well, okay, we'll just move on. So Hubble's made discoveries not only of small bodies, we've actually detected moons around other planets, so almost all the moons of Pluto, for example, which is a minor planet. Sorry, Pluto. But we detected all of the moons before the New Horizon mission. That was really an essential thing that we were able to gain from remote observations, because as we sent a spacecraft to fly by Pluto, chances are you could possibly hit one of those moons if you didn't know exactly where they were, and that would have destroyed the entire mission. So these are critical things that we can actually do with telescopes, and Hubble has been the perfect example of the kind of science and opportunity that we have by doing remote observations. it's just going over 30 years now of operations and still going strong, and still a very, very informative observatory for not only astrophysics, but also planetary science. Oh, now it's going to go. Go figure. This is a fun little montage of everything. So showing you comets, all the different comets that we've been able to observe. I'm a cometary scientist, in case you didn't catch the hint. We've seen them merge. We've now actually observed interstellar objects. They look totally different from one another. We have some idea of where they come from, but we have no idea if all of them look like that. We've seen comets disintegrate and plunge into the side of Jupiter. We've watched the great red spot on Jupiter shrink. So this is a dynamic storm that's actually still growing and shrinking. Geysers erupting off of Europa, again, detecting the moons around Pluto. Watching other small bodies. And yeah, still one of our favorite telescopes of all time. I'm a Hubble generation scientist. This was the telescope that inspired my whole generation for astronomy, for astrophysics, for learning things about not only our solar system, but about deep space. And now we're entering a new era, and we have the James Webb Space Telescope. So this is the next generation space telescope. It's a lot bigger. So the James Webb Space Telescope stands about 3 stories high with the spacecraft. The mirror itself, the primary mirror, is a segmented mirror. It's 18 segments. They're coated in gold, and they're 6.5 meter in diameter. Well, the whole structure is 6.5 meter in diameter. I stand just over 1 segment tall. The sun shield is different than any other space telescope we've had before. It's most of them we put in this sort of cone-like structure or to protect the mirror as well as from debris and other things. And if you're in Earth orbit, for example, you get a lot more protection from the sun by putting your mirror and your optics within this type of a structure. We're 1 million miles away, so we have just a single sun shield. It extends about the size of a tennis court. And so it's quite big. And as I said, we're 1 million miles away, so we can stay nice and cold. The bottom side of the spacecraft always faces the sun, the Earth, and the moon, so we don't have any radiation actually warming up the telescope or the science instruments, cameras, and spectrometers that sit on the back side of the telescope mirror. This is really important because we are an infrared telescope, so we are sensitive to thermal radiation. So any amount of heat is actually noise for us, and it makes our telescope, our instruments, less sensitive. So this is why we're so far away. This is why we are so big. This is why we are gold. And this is why we are cold. So a lot of people ask me, why do we care about using different wavelengths of light to study planets or other objects in our solar system? And one of my colleagues, who's actually sitting in the audience, made this beautiful figure to help demonstrate why we do what we do. So what you're seeing here is the image of Uranus in the visible light, near-infrared, microwave radiation, and the thermal mid-infrared. And what you can see is if you look at the atmosphere of this planet, the different wavelengths of light actually probe different regions of the atmosphere. So this is really important to understand not only the composition of the atmosphere, but also what is actually happening. If there's actually photochemistry happening, how that influences the rest of the chemistry in the planet, or even the atmosphere itself. We know that there's clouds, there's other weather and things that are happening, but how that chemistry also percolates all the way down almost to the ground. So these are really important things to understand. And so by doing a whole complementary suite of multiple wavelengths with really good resolution, with really good spectroscopy, we can really start understanding what's going on. And this is why we use different wavelengths of light to study planets. So as I said, though, JWST has a funny structure. We're 1 million miles away from Earth, and we want to stay really cold. So that gives us this funny boat-like shape. But, and that means that we cannot point the telescope towards the Earth or the Sun. So the inner solar system is sort of out of our reach. We'll never be able to observe the moon. We'll never be able to observe the Earth. We'll never be able to observe Venus, unfortunately. However, we can observe pretty much everything else, including near-Earth asteroids, including comets that come into the inner solar system, including interstellar objects as they come in. So pretty much what I tell people, it's Mars on out. And we have already started this journey. So I'm going to start with the biggest object in the solar system outside of the sun, and that's Jupiter. This beast of a planet is absolutely fascinating. It's so fascinating we've dedicated all types of resources into studying it. A whole fleet of spacecraft have gone to it, and we study it routinely with ground-based telescopes as well as those such as the James Webb Space Telescope now and the Hubble Space Telescope. So what you're seeing over here are some ground-based images of Jupiter, so you can get some perspective of what we can actually do from the ground in both the visible as well as the near-infrared. This is a Juno mission, Juno image highlighting the Great Red Spot, which we've already briefly touched on. And you can see just having a spacecraft in orbit around one of these giant planets, you get so much perspective, really detailed understanding of what's happening with all these swirls and twirls, the giant storm itself, as well as the atmosphere, the aurora, etc. But as I said, using different wavelengths gives us a whole new light. So we have actually observed Jupiter and its system now with the James Webb Space Telescope. We actually did this even in commissioning because it is big and bright. We wanted to know if we could point this extremely sensitive infrared telescope that's absolutely huge in space at one of the brightest things in our solar system. And more importantly, whether or not we could use all of our instrumentation the way that we had planned to. So we use it as a test case to study what scattered light looked like, so how light from this giant bright planet filters into the other instrument's field of view, and whether or not it makes things too noisy for us to actually see anything. Turns out it works perfectly, just as we planned. So not only do you get Jupiter in the infrared, so this is a near-infrared image from one of our instruments, one of our cameras, you get to see the aurora on both the north and the south. You get a beautiful perspective of the Great Red Spot, which is not red in our images. We actually can see the rings quite readily. They come out because they're made of gas and dust, which actually is lit up at these wavelengths. We can see some of the smaller satellites, and we even see diffraction spikes from one of the brighter satellites, Io. We can blow it up for a different perspective. They added a third color in this image just so that you could get some sense of detail. But you can see we have glorious resolution across the surface of Jupiter, and we are able to now go in and study in really fine detail the composition across the entire disk, the aurora, the storms, and all this dynamic activity happening in real time. With the JWST resolution, so think of pixel size, as well as the spectral capabilities, the details that we're going to be understanding or learning from this telescope for not only Jupiter, but for our entire solar system are just bursting right now. We're really excited about the science to come out of this. Now, the brightest object in the solar system at infrared wavelengths, and actually one of the brightest objects we can observe with the James Webb Space Telescope, is Mars. So I don't know if you all saw it, but we had a release on Mars on Monday. So we can observe it, and it was actually my job when I started on the project to make sure that we could. So it was really exciting for me to see that we could on Monday. So I got a plus one on my review, my annual review. It's great. No bonus, though. I work for the government. So what you're seeing here is actually some ground-based observations that were done with an infrared telescope in Hawaii. And what they did was they had a whole series of observations of Mars that took months and months and months of time. One, because it's really hard to get time on that telescope, especially continuously. Weather, when Mars is in the field of view of the telescope, et cetera. All types of things created this that went into this project took a series of months of observations to do. And what they did was they were able to take the spectrum of methane, and they were able to make and simulate the map of what methane would look across the planet's atmosphere. With JWST, in less than a minute, we can do the same map. It is so sensitive, it takes hardly any time at all. It's a blink of an eye. And we can also cover other wavelengths of interest, so seeing how water and carbon dioxide actually vary. So these were simulations that were done as we were planning observations for the James Webb Space Telescope. And lo and behold, these were our first images. This team worked very, very hard. Because Mars is so bright, it tends to saturate all of our detectors pretty quickly. So as I said, it takes a matter of minutes, and then we're already saturating, so we can't take any more light in. So it's like staring at the sun. You just can't see anything. But at certain wavelengths, we were able to pull out some beautiful images. So this is the 2 micron from the near-infrared camera, and this is the 4.3 microns. So these are thermal images, or you can think of them as heat maps effectively across the surface. And while this yellow area is extremely bright and saturated, you can see that we're right at the limit of saturation because we can see a variation across the Hellas Basin. And you can even see the variation in the crater up here. You can see almost the ring of the crater. So this is really fascinating and intriguing, but even more importantly is the spectrum reveals all kinds of details that are they're just starting to get in the noise with. With Mars. But their first look, you can see that we have beautiful detections of carbon dioxide and water. So there's some gas phase water in the atmosphere, water on Mars. Whoa. My colleague does not like me for doing things like that. As well as carbon monoxide. This is really amazing to me that we have this type of spectrum coming from Mars with just a blink of an eye with the James Webb Space Telescope. As I said, this team is working really hard to really pull out other signatures and see what the potential for detecting other organics, including methane, in the atmosphere of Mars will be like. So remember these guys that I said we've only visited once? Well, the good news is James Webb will allow us to actually study these objects in quite a bit of detail. So this is the mid-infrared instrument field of view. So this is what our camera would see if we were looking at these two objects. So we have Uranus and Neptune. These other images are a smattering of ground-based observatories and Hubble. So you can see the variation that we get at different wavelengths, and you can see how perfectly they fit in the mid-infrared field of view. So one of my colleagues, she says that James Webb Space Telescope was designed to study the ice giants. She studies ice giants. And she's absolutely excited and ecstatic about what we can do. While we didn't get the mid-infrared observations, we did actually get the near-infrared camera images. So these were just released this morning, and it was really, really, really exciting to see Neptune in all of its infrared glory. So this is the full image, so the full scale with the near-infrared field of view. This is the brightest satellite, Triton. It's an icy nitrogen surface, so it's extremely reflective, so it looks like a star, and it's quite spectacular here. Neptune is mostly methane, which at optical or visible light, that actually looks very, very blue. So when we go and look at the Hubble image, it's very, very, very blue. And that's because of methane. But at infrared wavelengths, there's so much methane, it actually absorbs. So you don't see that color, but you do see these bright little highlighted areas, and you can see it in the blown up version as well. And that's basically methane clouds in the atmosphere. Remember, we're probing a different area of the atmosphere now, so we can study the composition of these clouds in ways that we haven't been able to do before. And then there's the rings. We haven't seen the rings since Voyager, at these wavelengths at least. And it's just astonishing how they just pop out. It's like, yeah, there's rings, duh. This is really, really exciting, and I'm really looking forward to the science that's going to come out of these observations of the ice giants. especially as we're now in planning phases for the next big mission for planetary science, which will be a mission going to the Uranus system. So stay tuned for more science, especially on Uranus, and even more coming from Neptune as well. So things that we have in the plans, we have our whole first year of science actually planned and in the schedule to be observed. Every year we put out a call for proposals for people, scientists or not, all over the world to propose to use the telescope. It is reviewed by a series of scientists that we put on a panel, and so you get a peer review and a rank. If you are ranked high enough, you actually get to do your science. Europa, one of the ocean worlds, so a hot topic in planetary science, is one of our objects of interest for the first year of science. We have a lot of plans for Europa. We're actually building a mission to go to Europa and study not only the surface, but also the plumes of gas that have been detected with the Hubble telescope. So what you're seeing here is this beautiful blow-up of this giant moon. It has an icy crust. The Hubble telescope observed plumes of gas, which are the blue contours that you see, coming out of the surface. We don't know why Europa randomly outgasses or has plumes of gas, but when it does, it's pretty cool. And it's even more cool that we think that it's water. So this means that the subsurface ocean is sort of water-like. Whether or not it's saline or any other variant, we don't know yet, but hopefully the James Webb Space Telescope will tell us. So we have this instrument on board, and so what you're seeing is this hatched area showing you what that instrument would look like if we put it across the surface of Europa. So when we point our near-infrared spectrometer, we have this beautiful grid structure, and each one of those squares is what we'll call a spaxel. So we get a full spectrum from every single one of these squares. And so we can study, just the way as I showed you we did with Mars, what the composition of not only the plumes are, if we catch them active, but across the entire surface of this moon. So this is really kind of a cool experiment. You can imagine if you have a plume of gas coming out from an icy body, some of that's actually gonna recondense back onto the surface. It's just gonna freeze back on there. So think of lava coming out of a volcano, and you see all the lava that deposits on the surface of the Earth. Same kind of thing, except for it's ice. So we're gonna get these icy volcanoes spewing out material, and some of it's actually gonna go back onto the surface. So even if we don't catch the plumes in activity with the James Webb Space Telescope, we'll hopefully see these new fresh ice layers on the surface that will give us some insight into whether or not the plumes actually happened and or what the composition of them may be. So this is a really exciting project that's coming up in the next month or so. So stay tuned. Interstellar objects. I have to talk about interstellar objects because, well, I got to study one of them in a lot of gory detail. So we've had two that we know of today. One is what we call one interstellar object, 1I, Oumuamua. Some may say cigar, some may say spaceship. We say interstellar object. And the other one is 2I, Borisov, and it looks more like a comet. These are totally different objects. This one acted like a comet. It had outgassing like a comet. It even had a composition of molecules that looked like a comet, even though the numbers of molecules varied in ratio a bit. They both come from extremely different areas. You can see totally out of the plane of the solar system. And so identifying these types of objects before we can actually point JWST on them is something that's really essential. And this is where some of the other facilities I'm going to talk about in a second will come into play. But if we identify one, soon enough, we can point the James Webb Space Telescope at it. And we can basically do better science than any other observatory on these objects. That's because of the wavelength range that we cover. We can study the composition in ways nobody else can. We don't have to worry about the atmosphere or redshift of the lines because of the Earth's rotation. So this is a really exciting opportunity for us, and fingers crossed we have another one discovered in the near future. And I couldn't have a presentation today without mentioning a really fun project we're doing next week. So on September 26th at 7 p.m., there is going to be a spacecraft crashing into an asteroid. Because we're Planetary Science and we're NASA, we like to blow stuff up. not necessarily. But it's really fun when we do. And this is intentional this time. So we're actually doing this intentionally. And actually, one of the project scientists is sitting in the audience, so he's probably really excited that I have this. JWST is actually going to be observing this impact event, and it's one of the two large telescopes in the world that can actually see the impact when it happens. Because it's going to happen over the Indian Ocean and at a random time of the day where there's no telescope, big telescopes, the Hubble Space Telescope and the James Webb Space Telescope are really the best opportunities we have to study this impact event. And so all hands are on deck. We're really excited. So stay tuned for next week. And fingers crossed everything goes well, and we get our observations in, hopefully in time for the press conference. And there's still more to come. I don't know about you all, but every morning, my coffee routine is checking the JWST observations feed on Twitter, and it tells you what JWST is actually observing, for how long, what the project is. And a couple of days ago, we had Pluto and Charon, as well as a whole series of asteroids. These are actually observations that were helping us plan for the DART impact, so that's really kind of exciting. So stay tuned. There's all kinds of science coming every single day with JWST. But speaking of asteroids, there's a lot of them. There's a lot of small bodies in our solar system, and we know most of the big ones. We don't know all of them. And so figuring out where they are, as well as what they're made of, and whether or not any of them are going to come at us, is kind of something we want to know. So what we need to do is understand how to study all of these in bulk. And it's pretty easy to do just by staring at the sky. So this is a deep field image that was taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. And if you don't remove the asteroids, what you get are these tiny little streaks. And these little streaks are actually the small bodies of the solar system photobombing this beautiful deep field that's thousands of galaxies from the Hubble Space Telescope. There's seven unique objects, even though there's more streaks than that, and that's just because of the observation. We kind of move the camera around a little bit so that we can avoid instrument effects and other things. So you get some repetitive things, but there's five new asteroids that were identified in this one observation. So that's pretty cool. We can do this really routinely, and with the sensitivity of a giant telescope, this is something that's going to happen every time we point the telescope. So this is a really fun way to discover these small bodies. But the Hubble Space Telescope doesn't want to sit and stare at the sky, especially in the ecliptic, and try to detect these objects. So what we're doing is we're building huge telescopes to actually survey the ground. So one of the up-and-coming is a large ground-based telescope known as the Vera Rubin Observatory. This is going to be a surveying telescope that's going to survey the southern sky for about a decade. And every time we go across the sky, it's looking for things to happen, supernova to go off, small bodies to move, new discoveries, new phenomenon, things that we don't just sit and stare and wait for. But that's what this telescope is designed to do. So when I talk about big telescopes, I'm also talking about big fields of view. That means we're looking at big swaths of the sky at a given time, as well as the giant telescopes just as huge light buckets. So this is going to be one of our next up and coming, and hopefully sort of the start of discovery for a lot of new small bodies. All right.
LSST will observe the entire available night sky every few nights. So over time, we get fainter and fainter, and we can see faint galaxies that have never been detected before, or those faint little wispy things on the outskirts of galaxies that you otherwise couldn't detect with a single image. With every new image taken, the software will identify. So if an object gets brighter or fainter or appears
So this is sort of what the 10-year accumulative visits will look like. That's kind of hard to see, I apologize. So you're seeing this whole blue area. The darker regions are when we cover the sky multiple times. And you can see that we actually do cover the ecliptic quite a bit. So over the 10-year mission, program, the Large Synoptic Survey program, Ruben will observe the Southern Hemisphere, collecting more than 2 million images with its really big telescope, 8.4 meters. That's really big to me because I usually work with space telescopes, but for ground-based telescopes, that's chump change anymore. But we have a massive camera, 3,200 megapixel camera. So what they're working on now is optimizing how to do this survey. So that really depends on the kind of science that you want to do. So you can imagine if you're trying to detect asteroids, they move pretty fast. So you need to see the same area of the sky pretty quickly so that you understand where that one asteroid is moving from. If you wait too long, it'll move too far away and you won't know where it came from. So you want to see it move with respect to the same background stars or galaxies. So that's one science case for this particular observatory. However, if you want to look for Kuiper Belt objects, they move a lot slower. So you need to wait a bit longer to see them actually move any significant amount of distance from their background stars or galaxies. So there's a whole trade space going on right now with this observatory, understanding the science priorities, one of which is actually small bodies in the solar system, as well as those like transient optical sky, mapping the Milky Way in general, and the nature of dark matter. So balancing all of these different science objectives and what we can get in the return from this observatory is something that's going on and should be finalized sometime in the next year. With the survey, though, this is what we are hoping to get. So near-Earth objects, main belt asteroids, Jupiter Trojans, so these are asteroids captured by Jupiter, trans-Neptunian objects, so these are the outer solar system small bodies, comets, and interstellar objects. What we currently know, how LSST is going to improve our current knowledge base of these objects. This one's my favorite. New interstellar objects is something I'm really excited about. But I will say, as a cometary scientist, this number is very compelling. And hopefully we win a lot more JWST time. So this moves me to the next survey that's coming from NASA. The Ruben Observatory is actually a ground-based telescope, so it's operated and financed through the National Science Foundation. But NASA has its own survey mission that's going to be flying, and this is the next priority for the astrophysics decadal before to have a surveying telescope. So after JWST, we wanted to be able to survey the sky, detect planets around other stars, as well as map the entire sky with extreme sensitivity. So we have the Roman Space Telescope. It has a field of view that's 100 times bigger than the largest field of view of the Hubble Space Telescope. This is JWST's camera that I was just showing you images from. So you can see the field of view that we can see on the sky with this particular observatory is huge. So mapping the entire sky is going to be something that's actually quite feasible for this mission. Now you can imagine staring in the right place at the right time, we can actually start studying some of these small bodies. And this is going to be mostly serendipitous detections of these small bodies moving across the fields of view, the same way as I showed you with the Hubble Space Telescope. They're currently working on what these surveys are going to look like, how big they are, and where in the sky they're actually going to be. One of such is this high latitude survey. It's going to be 2,000 square degrees. So this is just showing you how much area of the sky compared to the largest Hubble Space Telescope sky survey that was ever done. So we're going to get amazing new science and discoveries coming from this new large survey telescope. A perk from being in space instead of on the ground is we have access to both the Northern Hemisphere and the Southern Hemisphere. So some of the surveys that are being organized and thought through. You can see where they actually lie with respect to the entire Earth, but There is no constraint on this yet. These proposals are still in planning phase. So hopefully people are thinking about how we can use this in ways that complement the Rubin Observatory. And I assure you they are. Not to mention, even if we do have stuff that's just out of the plane of the solar system, we do have these interstellar interlopers that do come from random parts of the sky. So it's still going to be critical for detecting and understanding those types of objects. But for the outer solar system, we'll be able to reach about a 20-kilometer diameter object with each set of exposures. These are a lot of science words and numbers, but it's fun to get sort of a sense that we have done the calculations, and we do know how well we will do. And we can get a sense of how well we're going to do compared to other facilities. So stay tuned for what's happening with the Roman Space Telescope. It's due to launch in 27. One fun project I'm going to highlight briefly is the inner Oort cloud. So the Oort cloud is something we haven't been able to detect yet. And so what we're trying to do is understand whether or not with some of these surveying telescopes, if we could actually detect the Oort cloud. Right now, it's just a theory. So until proven, it's a theory. And we believe that it's a real prominent area because we have comets that come from a region that we believe is the Oort cloud. So what we're hoping to do is set up a series of observations that we can actually start trying to detect the inner Oort cloud by basically stacking the images in a sort of systematic manner. And what we can do is we can look at the sensitivity of what we believe are the most extreme small bodies in the outer solar system. So how far away they are. This object, I think its common name is far, far away, which is kind of funny. But you can see how bright they are as you get closer to the sun, and then they get really, really faint. So having an understanding of how faint these objects get when they get really, really far away, as well as how cold they are, is something that we have to put into our simulations so that we can understand what the realm of possibility is for detecting the Oort cloud. And we have a lot of really good potential, especially if we consider the cadence of what we're actually mapping on the sky. So if you change that cadence, you see objects that are a bit brighter, but if you go a little bit fainter, so you're basically sitting in a given spot in the sky a bit longer to collect more light, it changes that rate that you can actually move, but you can detect fainter and fainter objects and really push into the outer solar system. Irregular satellites are another fun topic that we can do with these sort of surveying telescopes. So what you're seeing here are the hill spheres of the giant planets in our own solar system. So what this is the area around a planet based on its gravity, its mass, that it actually captures objects. So by stacking these large fields of view, you can imagine that we can do a full survey, sort of searching the area around Jupiter to see if we can actually detect any of these objects that have been trapped or captured within its general vicinity. And it shows you how many pointings it would take for any of these really trivial amount of observations, but something that we can do and we should do just to understand what the small body population really looks like in the vicinity of our giant planets. And what's in the future? So the new astrophysics decadal came out, and they have big plans for the next big telescope. So beyond the Roman Space Telescope, what is coming next? And what's been prioritized from the decadal is a mission that's sort of the combination between a super Hubble telescope and a habitable planet detection machine. And so they're calling it LUVEX right now. Hopefully that name changes. This is actually a simulation of the LUVOIR, so the Super Hubble Telescope. They had a couple of concepts that were put forward, and this telescope is really cool. It's dynamically moving with respect to its giant sunshield. The JWST is fixed, so we can't actually move the mirror with respect to our sunshield. So this will open up a lot more area of the sky to actually observe. And it's huge. We're talking 8 meters for a space telescope. So you saw how we had to unfold it. It almost like curled around just so that we could fit it into the fairing of a rocket, whereas JWST sort of folded, you know, origami-like. This one has to almost wrap and curl. So there's a lot of engineering that will go into the development of this next observatory, but people have been working on this concept for quite a while. In addition to the engineering, we've also been trying to understand what science we can do. And with our own solar system, so these are the two different ones. So LUVOIR B is the smaller sort of 8-meter level. LUVOIR A is sort of a 15-meter scale telescope. And you can see with comparison to what we've done with Hubble, so these are real Hubble images of Pluto, and this is the Europa plume that I showed you earlier. What we could do with these huge Hubble telescopes, we can even start approaching the resolution of what New Horizons saw on Pluto. So this is really fantastic discovery space coming in the future and something to be excited. So with that, I just want to say this is just the beginning. James Webb Space Telescope is really where we are starting with the next generation space telescopes. It is the next generation of science, and it is going to rewrite the textbooks. Thanks for your time.
Do we have questions for Dr. Milam? Or do you want to start in the front or in the back or go? Sure.
I can do it if you want.
You can
go ahead.
And repeat the question if you can.
Before I moved back here a year ago, I spent 5 years living at the McDonald Observatory.
Oh, fantastic.
And we're partners. I'm out of date on the science, so things have changed. But we're also partners in the Giant Magellan Telescope. And I wonder if the difference between the Rubin and the those giant telescopes that are happening.
That's a great question. So the question was how other big observatories on the ground, like the Giant Magellan Telescope, compares to the Rubin. So the difference between Rubin is it's designed to do these large surveys. So it has what we call fast optics. So that means that while we have a giant mirror, we're actually trying to focus a lot of that light in a way that we see more area of the sky. Whereas you think of most big telescopes, they're pointed in really tiny pieces of the sky, like the James Webb Space Telescope. And so what it's designed to do is actually to observe with the right resolution and sensitivity with this huge piece of glass, with this huge camera, in a way that is not, we're not able to do with a lot of ground-based facilities. So that's the difference. It's a really dedicated surveying machine.
That's cool. Thank
you. Yeah, absolutely. Here. Go ahead.
I'd like to thank you for the talk. I'm actually going with my archives conference to tour Goddard next month.
Great.
Which, if any, of these telescopes can be considered a successor to the planned but never launched terrestrial planet finder from a while back?
So which of these telescopes would be a successor for a terrestrial planet finder? And I think it's the last one I just showed you, this new LUVEX. So LUVEX is a combination of a super Hubble telescope, but also a dedicated habitable exoplanet mission. And there was two studies that were put forward to the astrophysics decadal for the National Academies, and one was this habitable exoplanet mission. And what they decided was because the science or the engineering and instrumentation for the two missions were so comparable, they thought meshing the two would give a better science return, bring us to the realm of detecting habitable worlds or Earth-like planets around other stars, but also enable all the science of a super Hubble space telescope. So that's probably the closest thing to a successor.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
On the interstellar objects, one, is it just serendipitous that we're able to find these in the sky? And the other part is there a reason they're not captured by the sun's gravity? And do they continue out of the solar system?
Yes. So interstellar objects are serendipitously discovered so far. People have been looking in the right area of the sky at the right time. They are not captured by our solar system because they're moving so fast, and they're at a trajectory where the orbit and their gravity is never bound to our sun or Jupiter. Sometimes our our small objects are bound to Jupiter. So they literally just fly right through. They go extremely fast, which is going to be a challenge for the James Webb Space Telescope even, and a lot of ground-based telescopes to track these objects as they come in and out of the solar system because they are going so fast. But yeah, they're not bound. They come and go pretty quickly, like, you know, a rude relative. And yeah, they're exciting, though. They're giving us a little bit of insight into what the small bodies of other planetary systems look like, whether they look like our own asteroids or our own comets. But then we also have to understand why they look the way they look. Is that because they've been cooked from their journey, you know, across space from their other planetary system, or is that just how they were actually preserved? And so we have a long way to go with our instance of two that look totally different from one another. So this is why it's really exciting to have these new surveying telescopes that will be looking all over the sky and really be able to tell us if we have new objects coming in. Yep.
I've noticed a lot of the photos that have been released have credits to citizen scientists for doing the data processing. How are you using that, and how important is that to NASA?
That's a great question. So a lot of the observations that are coming out for the James Webb Space Telescope have citizen scientists getting credited. That is because of the nature of technology today. We're in a whole new era of science. And a lot of the programs on the James Webb Space Telescope that have been revealed so far have what we call unlimited access. So anybody in the world can get that data as soon as the observations are taken. This was designed so that astronomers and planetary scientists all over the world, as we prepare for the next year of science, actually got to put their hands on data and understand what things look like. Whereas in a normal observation program, the scientist that owns that program gets to hold on to their data and hoard it for an entire year, and nobody else gets to see it, and it's all theirs, and it's mine, mine, mine. And they're not usually very happy to share that data until it's published, which can take some time. So what we're seeing, especially with the James Webb Space Telescope right now, is the access to this data with no proprietary period has really turned on the whole citizen science regime, and they're actively going in. They're monitoring the Twitter feed to see what observations are happening, whether or not that data is accessible, and as soon as it is, they're on it and delivering amazing images. What we're trying to do on the project side is we're really trying to not only foster that, we really enjoy and appreciate the work that they're putting into it, but we also want to do a little bit of policing to make sure people aren't putting salami out there. So we have a process where we get the images in, and if somebody's interested in putting that out as a product from JWST, then we do a mini review. So we look at that data, we go through their processing that they've done and make sure they did the right thing. So if you think about the first image that was of an exoplanet that came out from JWST, you can imagine with software these days, people can go in and seed planets in any system that they want. So we want to do sort of a check and balance before this goes through peer review, just to make sure things are actually legit and no more salami.
On the screen, it says new discoveries await. In your opinion, what would be the greatest discovery by James Webb?
That's an excellent question. So new discoveries, we don't know. And that's the best part about working on this project. There's so much. So we built this telescope and designed it as best we could. We over-designed it. We wanted it to enable all the science that we could possibly come up with that we know we want to do, as well as potential science for the future. But science changes every day. There's new discoveries, there's new things happening. When the James Webb Space Telescope was conceived, exoplanets weren't a thing. So that's something we had to work into our design. How do we actually start studying planets around other stars? And we're now imaging black holes. That's something that we didn't have when JWST's instruments were already delivered to, you know, Goddard to become part of the space hardware. So there's new discoveries happening every single day. And I think that's the most exciting thing, is what science is going to happen next. The Hubble telescope was launched and started taking images before planets around other stars were even known as well. And scientists were so creative in ways to actually use the Hubble telescope, because we have no instrumentation on board designed to study planets around other stars. But they figured out creative ways to look at where the struts hold the mirror supports. They use that as sort of a way to block starlight so that they can see planets around other stars. They can do spectra now by just basically staring at the star and streaking the spectrometer away from it so that they can study the composition of planets. There's amazing ways that people can use telescopes. You give them a telescope, they're going to figure out how to use it. And so that's what we're really trying to do, is not only with the James Webb Space Telescope, but with all these future generation of facilities, really enable the scientists to come in and use the observatory in the way that they think that they can to make these new discoveries.
So one of the things you mentioned that that was being looked into in the future for projects would be studying the nature of dark matter. Could you elaborate on like what kind of processes might be used to do that?
Studying dark matter, no. I'm a planetary scientist. I can try and highlight a little bit of it for you, but it's not really my field. Yeah. I'm not as well versed or educated or read or interested. It is something we are setting out to do, though. I will say the James Webb Space Telescope has projects aligned with focusing in on how we can study dark matter in more detail. Basically, we're looking for the implication of dark matter. So we're trying to study the environmental effects that it has. The Roman Space Telescope, though, is definitely on the verge of what we're going to be able to discover as far as dark matter and dark energy go. And that's sort of, I think, going to be the next big breakthrough, is these surveying capabilities at the right sensitivity and the right wavelength. Because with the James Webb, you're looking at such a tiny little piece of sky. Understanding how dark matter influences that is really, yeah. So it's looking more towards the future with the Ruben and Roman Space Telescope.
Thank you, everybody.